Blog Talk Radio.
Hey everyone, I'm Steve Bacic, and you're listening to Pam and Dawn. Don't mess with them.
Hello, and welcome to the special edition of Christmas Movie Spotlight. I'm your host, Dawn Mack, and I'm here with my friend, colleague, and host, Pam. Hi, Pam. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing well. How about yourself?
You know what? Are you trying to imitate my accent?
I was wondering if you'd catch that.
I was doing great, by the way. And oh my gosh, you tried to do a southern accent. Y'all, she's from Chicago. I just said y'all on the air.
Yes, you did.
I just really told how southern I am. I don't say y'all a lot, but still. Not that enunciated, at least. Sure, right, Pam says.
Yeah.
But she just tried her hand at a southern accent, and I don't know.
But it was very subtle. I didn't, you know, do the cartoon version of it, so it was very subtle.
It was subtle. It was subtle maybe to some, but to me, I caught it right away. I was wait a minute.
I was wondering. Where did Pam go
and what have we done with her?
I mean, half the time I talk to you, you don't even listen to me, so there. So
I most certainly do, thank you, and certainly I would know right away if you were trying to feign a southern accent in a Chicagoan voice.
Yep.
So I don't know what else to say. I don't know what to say. But
hey,
I do know what to say here, and that is our guest for today's show, OMG is all I can say. What a special interview this was. From start to finish, he was incredible, and I'm talking about Steve Bacic.
Let's not even say anything. Let it be a surprise for the listeners. I mean,
yeah.
If they don't love it, there's something wrong with them.
All I can say is he was so highly entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
Another one of those, as many of our interviews are, it could go on forever and ever and ever. So he was just so, and you'll find out soon enough, folks. It just was great.
Yes, and Steve stars in the Hallmark Movies and Mysteries holiday movie, Time for Him to Come Home for Christmas, premiering Saturday, November 26th at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 Central.
And we are so excited and honored to bring you our interview with Steve Bacic.
Enjoy the show.
Hey, Steve. Thanks a lot for calling in. We really appreciate you taking the time out of your busy schedule to join us today.
Well, thank you. Most people don't take my call.
No.
No.
Yeah.
Nobody forewarned
my family.
Us.
Nobody tells me. So, yeah, you don't have caller ID, so I'm glad you answered.
Yeah. Yeah.
You guys got to get a budget. That's how people, they screen me. So,
exactly.
Yeah.
We got to get some help done.
I know, for real. Are we big time enough yet that we can have call screeners and caller ID and all that?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think we've made it yet.
No.
I think you guys have, don't you have handlers handling that?
Nope.
You know what? That's coming. I understand that's coming. So, but right now, it's just she and I, you know, for the moment.
Okay. Okay.
I don't know if we want handlers, though.
No.
Really just depends.
Her and I are pretty controlling.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah.
We would be controlling the handlers. So, I don't know that would work out so great.
Mm-hmm. No, then you got to handle. That's right. You got to handle the handlers. Then who's handling you?
That's right.
Right.
See.
Right.
Yep.
So you could complicate this a lot.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's
no
why it's a two-man show right now, because her and I know how each other works and we know what our jobs are, and we get along just fine.
There you go. Sometimes a small team is the best team. You
yes.
Know?
Yes, exactly.
Where are you, ladies? Where you said you're different cities?
Yes,
I'm in Chicago, and Dawn's in North Carolina.
North Carolina. That's just close to South Carolina, right?
That's correct. And next door to Tennessee.
Tennessee. I was almost in Nashville for a convention just before COVID. And then it moved to Toronto, actually. But I was looking forward to it. I would have loved to gotten down to Nashville, did some exploring, you know, listen to some music. Mm-hmm. But it never happened.
Yeah, Music City Row down there in Nashville, it's just amazing. I've been to Nashville once, and I said it would be my last time. I love to go and just, you know, you stand on the street, and you're just hearing all this live music, and it's just a great, great place to be.
Yeah, I love that. All right, so let me see. My first question for you, how did you become podcast host?
I love it. Pam, you want me to take it, or do you want to take it?
Yeah.
We both had different reasons. I mean, I used to listen to podcasts, and then I started calling into podcasts, and then somebody asked me to be their co-host, and I did that for a while, and then they stopped their show, and then people like Dawn said, well, you should start your own podcast. And I said, no, I'm not doing it by myself. You're going to have to go with me, and then here we are.
There you go.
Okay.
we've done stuff independently. We've done stuff together. We've interviewed, gosh, I've lost count of how many people we've interviewed over 10 years, and done our thing separately. We both love music, so I run a couple of internet radio stations, and she was doing an indie music podcast for a while, and so was I, and you know, and we've just collaborated a lot more than not over the past 10 years. And then we started this show, Christmas Movie Spotlight, 4 years ago. And we took, this is the fourth season. We took 2 seasons off because of COVID and just some different personal things. And so this year we kind of said, well, do you want to, you know, you want to resume? And honestly, we didn't know how it would be because we'd kind of been off canvas with this show for 2 years. But man, I think this is our busiest year yet. So we have really had fun so far talking to folks and just doing our show. And so far, so good.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of actually today I went into the first time I was in a room in 3 years, I guess.
Yeah.
Normally, we're doing everything on remotely. So I'm lucky I have a studio in my house. So but a lot of people don't. So I guess it's hard for them. But honestly, I preferred being home. And but it was also nice to see people again, and I think everyone's anxious to interact again.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So. You don't realize how much you miss it until you don't get to do it, and then when you finally get that opportunity again, it's really great. It's a good feeling.
Right, yeah. For sure.
Absolutely.
Cool.
So, should we go ahead and ask you your first question?
Oh, if you're alive. Yeah. I mean, listen, I don't know if the words coming out of my mouth are going to be true or not. So, they're just the opinion of me.
We have to believe whatever you say because we can't, you know, find out if that's not true or otherwise.
Well, you could. He's not 7 foot tall. Yeah.
Just about.
He's a terrible dancer. He's just a terrible dancer. Yeah. I'm figuring this out. Yeah.
Well.
Yeah.
We would love to hear how you got started in show business. I mean, what said to you?
Oh, man. Well, it definitely wasn't, you know, as most people when they're young, which, you know, I'm still young at heart, but you don't know what you really want. I had different aspirations. Let's just say I really wasn't someone that thought about acting as anything I would do seriously. And I'm from Southern Ontario, Windsor, which is right across from Detroit. It's a very industrial city. Like we had the big three auto companies there back in the day before they started getting shut down. And, you know, everyone I knew was either going to pharmaceuticals or working in the factories. And you know, it wasn't an option, at least in my world. So it was never really part of my consciousness. There was one time in university where I had some friends that were modeling and trying to do commercials in New York and Toronto. And they were always saying, well, you should do some modeling, or you should do this or do that. So I'm like, yeah, no, that's not what I do. But there was an ad in the local paper about an acting class. So, and it turned out to be not a very good person that was running the class. He created some really, like, this is what I'm saying. People can create any story they want about what their credentials are, especially back then, because there's no Google. You couldn't really look people up. And it turned out he was not a very nice person, a bit of a con man, almost convinced me to go to Buffalo to be the head of his other acting school. Like, he was trying to set up franchises across Canada, across the States, but he never did anything legitimately in his name. He had aliases. I happened to know this police officer who saw me. He saw me at a wedding, and he came in and interrupted one of our classes. Two cops came in, and he called me personally and warned me about this guy. Wow. Apparently, again, very, very, wow, very dangerous guy. He assaulted a Texas Ranger. I guess he spent some time in the States. He was wanted down there, and then they were keeping an eye on him in Canada. So, of course, I politely quit the class. The cop gave me some more some information about the guy, and fortunately, all I lost was a little bit of money. And then I got a really, really bad taste in my mouth for acting. Like, I just thought, this is not the kind of world I want to be part of. I'm very, very practical. I'm funny, as you can maybe tell. I don't know. I like to have fun, like, joke around, right? That's just my thing. And, but, you know, all that aside, I had a certain idea in my head about what the industry was like. And now with this guy, he kind of reaffirmed that and wanted nothing to do with it. But cut to a few years later, I've graduated. I started working for one of my professors, doing some consulting in kinesiology, which is, you know, basically human movement, biomechanics, that sort of thing. And I had some friends that wanted to start a bit. Again, I'm just giving the things that distracted me from acting. I started a small business, which I did not like. And I'm basically making an okay life accidentally in Windsor, until another old friend comes up and says, hey, how'd you like to do a road trip? So he and a few other guys I knew were heading out west. When we were in Vancouver, we saw a film set, and I got this feeling, you know, I just got this really, really weird feeling. I never expected to move away from Windsor. Never expected to move out west for sure, or L.A. by any means. But there's something about it, and I couldn't shake it. And I decided to, maybe about 3-4 months later, once we'd done our road trip, I decided I wanted to go back, and I was probably going to go to L.A. But I didn't have enough money. I didn't have my visa. I didn't have my green card, nothing. So I just stopped in Vancouver. And I thought, well, you know what, I'll give it a go. Between some modeling and some acting, I figured I could make a go of it. Well, of course, I started waiting tables again.
No.
I had another few years of those. So I guess I was a real actor right away because I was waiting tables.
Right.
yeah. But yeah, actually, it was just, if I'd never gone on that road trip, I never would have been an actor. And what I didn't realize was that there was an industry just north of me by 3 or 4 hours in Toronto I could have gone to, but that, for whatever reason, was never an option for me. And, you know, Vancouver became home. I never quite made it to L.A. I did end up in L.A. working on shows and things like that eventually, but I've basically worked Europe, Canada, U.S. I've been pretty much everywhere with work now, but... Vancouver became home, And I started my acting career. I've tried to quit a couple of times, but I just can't. It's kind of stuck in me.
Part Please
of me, I
don't quit.
Well,
I know.
You know. Yeah, I mean, who knows? Who knows, right? I don't like to be thinking that there's no other way to live, but it's an interesting thing. And where I'm at right now is I'm more in the creating. I do like working as an actor, but I also like controlling sort of my destiny. And I think that if I'd started creating content earlier, I'd be in a different position right now. I don't know if I would be acting. I think I might be directing. I mean, yeah, directing, producing, doing some writing. Yeah, it's one of those things that I'm trying to evolve. Mm-hmm. And the worlds that interest me right now are the ones I can collaborate on or the ones I can write myself. Is that a lot? That's a long answer.
And that was a great answer.
And
you know, we always love to open with that question because there are no two answers alike. Every guest has a different story as to how they got started, and it's always fascinating for Pam and I. And so what was your first professional job as an actor, and what did you learn from it that you have followed throughout your career?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I started, waiting tables, I ended up doing a couple of extra gigs, you know, extras background work. I met Ethan Hawke when he was a young man, and I met Stephen Dorff. I don't know if Ethan's still a very, really, actually both actors are doing quite well still. But I met Ethan when he was, I think, 17, 18. He was doing some Disney movie. They came to my restaurant. They came in separate occasions. So my first experience on set was working as a background person on both their separately on their movies, and I really realized early on that I didn't want to do that. As fun as that was, I didn't like not being the person with the lines, you know. And but thankfully, shortly, maybe within the first few months, I think I got to Vancouver in about May, where I settled and got an agent, and then just before Christmas of that year, I read for 21 Jump Street when they were still shooting in Vancouver. And I went in for a couple of lines. The casting director's like, I think you're too old for this, because I think I was 26 at the time, and I was playing a high school kid, and I had the wits about me because I didn't know anything about the business to say, well, I think that the people who play the cops are adults pretending to be high school students. And she goes, oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
Let me leave. I did believe. And they would do pre-screens back then where, you know, they would judge you before they brought you to the live session. So I'd come in for the live session, and they're, like, looking at me kind of weird and like, hey, would you mind looking at this part? And I'm like, sure. I've never really experienced anything like that before. So I go, sure, whatever. And I was reading Michael Shurtleff's book. It's called Audition. And it's more for theatrical auditioning, but the same stuff applies. It's just a series of 12 prompts or guideposts that help you get into story and into character. So I was literally reading that book, and I had it with me. So I took the next scene, and I broke it down and went back in 20 minutes later. They really liked it. They gave me another one, and they really liked that. They gave me another one. And I was there for about 5 hours, and I'd never done anything before. And before I left, it looked really, really good. Then I get a call from the director a few days later saying, hey, congratulations, you got the part. And this was just before Christmas. And I was like, wow, I've never spoken. Now I'm doing 40 out of the 50 pages of the episode and was shooting into the new year. And, I thought these people are going to see I'm a fraud. But everyone was asking me, where are you from? Are you from the States? Where are you from? Like, you know, no one knew that I had never done anything on set before. Kind of fell into it. And the cool thing about being on set as a background person is I paid attention. And so I already knew what to do technically, you know? Mm-hmm. And I always give people that advice. If you're going to get in the business before you go study with anyone and waste money, you know, go spend some time as an extra on set and pay attention. You know, just it's not that big a deal, you know?
Yeah, that's good advice.
yeah, what we do is not that big a deal. But what we, if the people who do it really, really well, what they do is they surrender themselves, are vulnerable, and are insane. Like one of my first LA agents said, the camera loves insanity and vulnerability.
Okay.
And I go, yeah, that, yeah.
That's
yeah.
a new one on
well,
me.
Course, he had some pretty crazy clients, so maybe that's why he had that perception. But I think it's true, though. It's like what we do, what you inherently watch when you get pulled in is the innermost their essence. You know, if you do it well, you can eliminate somebody. You can eliminate the words that somebody else wrote and just be there. And then we have this. There's different ways to do a character, but in essence, when you forget the words that you're speaking, you yourself are there. It's part of you. So,
yeah.
Which I think is one of your questions coming up, but it's,
and it's
you know, I'm a person who, I'm always questioning things. I'm always, you know, I'm curious and I want to know what motivates people for their behavior and in life and in the way I approach my work. And then, even if you have the information, you still have to execute, and that's the scary part because it leaves you vulnerable. It leaves you exposed to, you know, criticism and all those other things, right? So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely.
Another long-winded answer. Come on.
Oh, keep them coming.
Love
every minute.
Love it.
Stop.
We
don't
could listen to your stories all day, let me tell you.
Don't encourage them. You need to get rid of them. That's my handler talking. Yeah. Anyway.
Well, you're such a versatile actor. I mean, you seem to know how to learn everything from the bottom up. So would you say that's your most valuable skill?
Versatility? Actually, yeah. I mean, I'm definitely versatile. But I think it's because I have this interesting imagination. Also, I think I'm empathetic, and so I think one of the requirements I think of a good mind you, I'm saying these things. I'm not declaring that that's who I am or that's my ability. It's ultimately when you peel back everything, it's the way I would want to be ideally is. Have the ability to create a sensitivity to whichever character you are playing. So I think I do have empathy. I do have a great imagination. And so one of the things that I'm capable of doing is looking at the words on the page and seeing the story. And regardless of if it's something I personally have experienced or not, everything is relatable to me, but I try to imagine it from their perspective. One of the first things I tell people when they get a piece, because I've done a little bit of directing and coaching and things like that, is I develop basically four steps. But the first step, I call it overview. It's like stepping out of the story. It's as if you're a child and someone's reading you a Christmas story. And what does the child do? They just lay there and they see the story unfolding as they listen to you. It's the same thing I suggest, and something I do naturally is observe the story. And the cool thing is I get to observe the story and the essence of the emotion through all the eyes. I don't just look at my character. I look at everyone's characters, and it gives me a more full, hopefully a full character. You know, like they say, you make every angel has a little bit of a devil, and every devil has a little bit of an angel. And
true.
You try to create sympathy for the bad guy, and questionability for the hero. Is he really doing the right thing? You know, and you know if you play with that, it brings the audience humanity, and I think that's what you know most people want to relate to. Is that sense of humanity, you know?
Yeah, the more relatable it is, the better the audience, the more believable it is. I think it resonates with the audience, and it keeps the audience engaged throughout.
Yes,
And that's
and not everyone's going to relate to you in that way. Not everyone is going to buy it. I was actually just discussing a story. I'm currently trying to create something else. I trying to make another film on my own time, my own dime, and small crew. He was discussing the previous movie we had done, and how you check in 20 minutes later, it's essentially the same thing. What he was saying, it wasn't enough cliffhangers, but he's 26, and he likes things fast. They like things like, so I go, generationally, I am not going to speak to everyone. You can't speak to everyone. You know, how we relate to something is through our own, lens, our own filter. So for some people, it could be completely enthralling. To others, it's like they don't get it because they've not experienced that. So,
that's very true.
Just like you ladies with the show, the niche, your Christmas. Make the
that's
field
right.
and they will come. Field of dreams.
That's exactly right. Now, having been a producer and a director, what do you look for when deciding to take on a certain project?
Money.
Are you going to pay me?
Let's
get real now. Forget everything I said. It's all about the money.
It's all about the dollar. Almighty dollar.
No. I think that there's two reasons to do a job. There really is. Like an actor goes, well, why did I take this role? The material speaks to you or the money speaks to you. And sometimes if you're lucky, you get both.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, it's, if I get the opportunity to direct, for me, it is the challenge of being able to tell a story with a limited amount of resources. Because when I'm doing my things, it's like most of my energy is in solving problems creatively before they become a problem on set. So it's almost a mathematical equation for me. One of the things I realized when I was going through university, I was in an algebra class, engineering algebra, and algebra is basically formulas and theories and how they connect. I could see the through line in my mind, even though I'm dyslexic. So like reading scripts and even with math, the numbers are backwards sometimes. Well, what I could do is I could take ideas, concepts, things like that, and string them together so that they make sense. So formulas ended up making sense to me, whereas they might be confusing to someone else. As long as I get all the pieces of information, as long as I get all the components of a story, the essence of a scene, I can figure out a way to either give the actor maybe the subtext they need to connect the one thing to the other thing, or connect their relationship with the other characters, to give them a thought, to give them an emotion that, and I could give you a million reasons why and how to do a scene, dependent on, what do I want to do with you? Who are you? Where do you come from? And what are your beliefs? What are your core beliefs? And then you just create it. So for me, if I get an opportunity, yes, it's still money and it's material. So I don't have the luxury to do things for free except for myself. And then I try to obviously create stuff you want to sell and hopefully you get paid for it.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, some actors, and we're talking about when they have a dark part, playing a psychopath or something, they can't shake off that character when they go home, and some can. Which category do you fit into?
Well, I'm not a method actor, but I do hold the residue sometimes. It depends on – see, I like to – hurt me personally, I like to joke around a little bit on set because – I save my energy. If I stay light, I'm creative. If I focus too hard, I personally get one dimensional. I tighten up. There's a time. This is the way I work. There's a time to focus. For me, if I focus too early, because I do try to go deeply into the character, I get exhausted, And I'd say that there have definitely been times on set where I'm going, normally I get along with people, right? And I'm, you know, I remember this, I was doing this movie called The Cult, where I think it was a Hallmark movie as well. It was way back when. And there are, I'm now late to mid-30s, maybe close to 40. And the other bunch of actors are all in their early 20s and teens. And I'm their sergeant. And for whatever reason, this is the first time I experienced it, we're not getting along. And I realized it's because the characters in the movie weren't getting along.
Yeah.
And so I was like, that was the first really, because I've never adhered to being a method actor. I don't want to spend my life to become another life, even though that's what we do. We play all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Being a method actor, you do it consciously until you forget who you are. And you become this other thing. And there's, you know, obviously techniques for doing that. A lot of actors won't, you know, speak to you in any other way but in their character. Where, you know, that's not for me personally. Because I like to live my life. I want to be connected to the people in my life that are who they are, and I want to be who I am. But it's tricky because I'll tell you, even I remember just before, maybe a year before COVID, I had this one day where I had 5 auditions, and they were all slightly different or quite different. And I remember I was focused so intently, like focused on the first one, and then I had these little ideas for each character, and I focused on the next one, and the next one, next one. But at the end of the day, my brain was mush. I had no idea who I was. It took me time to recover because I just like, wait, who am I?
Right.
You know? So, it's pretty funny.
You had to kind of reach in there and find yourself, you know, among all that.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that, then you got to have the ability to tune back into your life. And I do that with breath. I just come back and, you know, exercise, breathe, you know, watch something funny with the family, that sort of stuff. And that gets me back to, because, you know, you can get stuck in your head at any time.
People in general,
they start believing the nonsense, and next thing you know, they're living it. So,
so true. Well, we are so excited. We can't hardly wait to see you in time for him to come home for Christmas, which will be airing on Hallmark Movies and Mysteries this holiday season. And oh my gosh,
I think it's end of November, right? I think
it looks like it's going to be an amazing story, just from what we've seen on the surface. What can you share about this movie without giving too much away?
Oh geez. Oh, wow.
Get your handler.
Well, I don't know. I mean, one of the things that I personally liked about this particular, at least for my character, was I was allowed to go a little deeper into my emotions.
Mm-hmm.
So they're devastating. There's two parallel stories that come together, and tragedies happened, and that's the cohesiveness, that's the thing, that the tragedy is the thing that brings these two worlds together 3 years into the future. And I mostly operated on one end by myself, and then the other characters, Holland and Tyler, were on the other end. We had these brief interactions, but what I really did enjoy about it was the ability to get vulnerable, and more so than, you know, any other Hallmark movie I've done or show I've done. So, I think you get to feel a lot. And, David Winning directed it. He's done a lot of great stuff. He's also a friend of mine. And they just, you know, they were very gracious. And, you know, there's a certain formula that you want to stick to, because of course we want to keep things upbeat for Christmas. I think what's cool is that it is relatable. Tragedy is relatable, but then at the end you also have hope. And we just got to go a little bit deeper this time, which I really, really enjoyed. So,
and that's one thing that Pam and I talk about often, especially this time of year. You know, the movies on Hallmark Movies and Mysteries during the holiday season, they have such a deeper story than the lightheartedness you find on the Hallmark Channel. And we're always watching the movies, of course, and so we'll be texting back and forth, and I'm like, I'm 30 minutes in, not even 30 minutes in, and I'm like bawling right now, you know, if it's on the mysteries. But is the movies, the content just makes you feel. And so when we saw that this one was definitely going to be on that channel, we were just like, oh, this is going to be so heartfelt. I just know it. So
get the Kleenex. Get the Kleenex.
That's right.
Young
stock in the company. So, you know, the whole Kleenex Corporation is like, you know, especially this time of year, but definitely.
Exactly. I didn't think of that. Maybe I should buy some Kleenex too.
There you go.
Be a good investment.
Yes, it would, because if all the women, well, maybe even some of the men, are like us when we watch Hallmark Mysteries, we start crying and we cry till the end. When it's a sad and then it's happy, we cry. So there we are.
That's right.
You know,
yeah.
We need the Kleenex.
I'm a crier. I'm a crier too. So
are you?
It don't take much. I don't cry. I don't know. I cry. It's weird because I'm a sensitive human being, and then you know, certain things, like my kids will laugh at me, and I just call them heartless.
Yeah.
And then they cry. And then I make them cry, see?
Yeah.
I'll show you heartless. Cry. Yeah.
That's right.
Make them feel guilty.
That's right.
Yeah. Right?
You too will cry. Yeah.
If you were to write your own Christmas movie, what would the plot be to get to the happy ending that we always get with these types of movies?
Well, actually, we pitched something for Hallmark, and mine involves an ex serviceman who's suffering with some PTSD. He's in the big city, and a parallel story is this female executive, she's an ad executive, who wants to become an anchor, and there's a spot that opens up, The anchor job will go to the person that comes up with the best Christmas story. But of course, this executive is jaded. I don't want to give away the whole story. But
right.
Basically, my story is told through a reindeer.
Oh.
They both end up on the same farm, magically. The proprietor is a guy who has to go away for a little while. He's looking for someone to take care of the place for him. And also to take care of the stock and the trees, the tree farm. And the ex-Marine doesn't realize what he's into. And when ad executive shows up on the same farm, they kind of have to work together. And the gentleman suffering PTSD doesn't trust his feelings. And through the help of the reindeer, who he confides in, it's called
I love that.
The Thought. And unfortunately,
that's right.
the person we pitched to moved to a different network. It may never see the light of day. It's much better than I explained it, but that's what it is. That's what I would say.
Dawn and I say, come on, Hallmark, get it done. Let's go.
That's
we're
right.
ready.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, We've got a treatment and everything, but who knows? We still might do it.
Well,
you never know.
It doesn't sound like anything that's out there or, you know, we've seen it. So that would be, it would be heartfelt. It would be entertaining. I mean, it's got everything. It covers all the bases. For a Christmas movie, you've left nothing out. So, so Pam and I will, you know, we will definitely promote that if it becomes reality. You can bank on it. Well, before we wrap up, we always like to play a little lightning round, which is Christmas theme. There are no wrong answers. We just love to ask these questions. But what is your favorite Christmas tradition?
Caroling, going door to door. And annoying people with my songs.
You know, I think he's the first person we asked that's caroling.
I've done caroling
two seasons in a row now, especially over COVID. I've gathered a team of neighbors, and we go annoy other neighbors. And it's actually fun.
But that's so traditional, though. That is wonderful.
It's
traditional.
We used to do it when I was a kid in my neighborhood, even though it was a dangerous neighborhood. We still did it back in the day, and
It's in just about every Hallmark movie, so, you know, it has to happen in real life. You know, people love seeing this type of stuff in the movies this time of year, so it's only natural that you should do it in real life, too. So what's your favorite Christmas song?
Well, I got two. My first would be Silent Night, and the next would be The First Noel.
All right. Favorite Christmas movie?
Elf.
And hot toddy or hot chocolate?
Hot chocolate.
And white lights or colored lights?
White.
That was easy,
Actually, what I should say, I don't like them mixed up. Like, I like I do like a nice blue. But I don't like because back in the day, I remember around my house, I didn't like the composition. You know, it's all about composition. Mm-hmm. I think it's solid lights are a little more elegant, you know? Yeah.
Well, everybody's entitled to their own taste, and that's why we have such a diverse world, and we say
absolutely.
Go for it, right?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
Well, we can't even begin to tell you how much we enjoyed speaking with you today, and we definitely would love to have you back sometime in the future with any new projects that you have, even your own Christmas movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Yeah.
That would be cool. All right. Well, I had a lot of fun too, so thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Since we will not be around and be talking to you during the holidays, we want to wish you and your family a blessed holiday.
Same to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good night.
All right,
lady.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Hey, this is Sly. You listening to Pam and Dawn? Is that Pam and Dawn, or is that Donald Pam? I don't know. Stop hitting me. Hey, Adrian.
Hey, guys, don't leave us yet. Be sure to follow us on Twitter at Christmas Movies. That's XMASMUVIES. And also like our Facebook page at Christmas Movie Spotlight. Don't forget, that's spelled M-U-V-I-E-S. And follow us on Instagram at Christmas Movie Spotlight.
And don't forget to check out our website, ChristmasMoviesSpotlight.com. That's movies with M-U-V-I-E-S, ChristmasMoviesSpotlight.com.
Thanks for listening. See you next week.